I'd like to go back today to nutrition of the mind. In a sense, because it's kind of always happening. When we talk about the four engines, that's our approach at Health Revolution: nutrition, movement, connection, and rest. If you go to the website and go to the articles, you can read the full elaboration of the four engines: nutrition, movement, connection, and rest. We could talk about that itself for a couple hours. But in a sense, we could say that a lot of what we're doing at Health Revolution and what we're starting with in these webinars is nutrition of the mind. Asking the question of what is true? How do we think about this? And in many ways, that's, we could say, is the biggest one. Because there is a constant messaging in our society about what is true and about how to approach life and what life is about. So there are the actions we have to take, even in nutrition, in terms of food that we eat or moving the body, the breath, the emotions, the ideas, connecting with oneself. So many of these are critical in terms of actually anchoring that experience, bringing that experience alive. And why is that? Well, if we get back to one of the core ideas we talk about in Health Revolution, which we don't talk about all the time, because it's not something that everybody can necessarily engage with, but one of the core ideas, the deepest ideas, is that this world is essentially consciousness. That even what we call materiality, what we call thoughts, feelings, emotions, time, space, dimensionality, anything, all of these are representations of consciousness in consciousness. Right, just as it happens in a dream, similar mechanism. And so, if we step out of that awareness for a second and just come back to the standard societal storytelling, the framing in society, right, there's the idea that you can have an idea and then you have to do some work to bring that idea to life. Think about an inventor as a classical example. They have an idea and they need to do work to realize it. Right? They need to gather the materials, they need to put it together and test it and get some feedback. And all of these actions are what materialize this idea, so to speak, right? In this world. Now you shift back to a primacy of consciousness view, and what is actually happening is this idea is becoming concretized over time. It's like a sculptor that's working on their base, right? Except that base, that foundation, that material is consciousness itself. And how do you work on that? You work on that from your, with your arms, with your legs, your thoughts, with your eyes, with your tongue, with your, basically your being, whatever tools and resources are available to you, this representation of consciousness. That is engaging this idea in every way possible. And that's how it becomes more and more real. In a sense, it becomes public rather than a private view. It becomes public view. And when it becomes a public view, we tend to say it's real because it's recognized in more than one perspective, from more than one viewpoint. Right? And this is often popularly talked about in word, in the sense of manifestation. People talk about manifestation, and that's a separate topic that essentially is talking about this mechanism. So, where does that start? Nutrition of the mind, meaning what we think is possible. Right? So, if you think about innovators or entrepreneurs or radicals or heretics or people who are considered crazy or insane, what they often have in common is that they don't really care what's supposed to be. Right? They just have an idea and they don't care if it's supposed to be one way or not. They simply have that idea and then they work on that and shape that until it comes out and becomes more real. So we're talking about nutrition of the mind because it's important to allow that space where we say everything is possible. Anything is possible. The rules that we have are rules that somebody made up, right? Some with our interests in mind, some not with our interests in mind. And if people had always listened to the rules, we wouldn't have most of the things we have today, most of the wonderful things that we have today. So nutrition of the mind is moving into that space, dropping the restrictions, dropping what is thought to be impossible, and reconsidering what we think the everyday is. What is it that is in front of our eyes? What is it that we are sensing? What is it that we are experiencing? How are we here? Why are we here? Reconsidering this fundamental platform of our lives is nutrition of the mind. And a small example of that is some of these stories that we have on our podcast. I was just going through some of the last few ones. I recently talked to Jeffrey Rediger, who is a psychiatrist at Harvard and also attended Harvard Divinity School. And he wrote a book called Cured, where he talked about, you know, many people who heal and what the commonalities were. And he told me about a story about a person who healed from melanoma, which is considered one of the most advanced types of cancers. And we actually had her on our podcast, right? What is the intelligence that helps her heal? Another one recently was Ruth, who was a marathon runner, had diagnosed with stage 4 breast cancer and reversed. She was already very fit. She was already running marathons. She changed her food and completely healed. This was, I think, decades ago. Since then, she has won many marathons. Right? Mee Oak, who had scleroderma so severe that she could hardly get out of bed. Skin was so tight, basically encased. So tight, can't move. And tried ayahuasca under the guidance of shamans or the people who are indigenous people, and started healing and is on her healing journey. Bubu Garcia, whose parents were both in gangs, who grew up in gangs, who was witness to murders, who became an alcoholic, who in a moment of insight, when he was out in nature, everything started to fall away, and he's helping others now, free of all that. He left the gangs and said so beautifully that people in gangs aren't bad people. They're looking for acceptance like everybody else. Dean, who had leukemia and decided to say no to his treatments that were advised and instead wanted to do what he always wanted to do, which is swim the river. And he swam it and he noticed that he healed. Leukemia went away. So we could go on and on and on. Most of these stories, I doubt any of these stories are in the medical literature, right? And most of these people don't want to be on YouTube telling their story. So if I can get 40 stories in a couple of years, I guarantee you there are 400 or 4,000 out there easily or more. And imagine what our society would be like if those stories were everywhere. Because a big part of it is a person telling themselves that this is possible. That's nutrition of the mind. How do we do that in a way that gives people maximum choice? Right? Because in the beginning stages, when you have a society that's so repressed and suppressed like our society is, and to me, it doesn't really matter if you're in the US or somewhere else in the world, it's pretty much one global mindset, more or less. When you have a society that's repressed like this, there's often a spring back, right? So the common conversation is, well, you know, we can't handle this information, or and everybody's just going to refute or deny, you know, any medical treatment and so on. And, you know, we have created that situation with the way we approach these things. It's inevitable. Such things are going to happen, unfortunately, you know, just like in any, whenever a person is suppressed, any one person in any area of their life, when they start to wake up, they'll go to the other side. That's natural because you're just breaking free. And ultimately you have to find your true north, right? And that will happen on a societal scale as these awarenesses, these truths, arise to the surface of our consciousness. So nutrition of the mind is realizing what's happening around us and realizing what is possible. And at a deeper level, realizing what this world is. Right, so when we hear these stories of Ruth and Miyoke and Boo Boo and Dean and 30, 40 others that we've talked to, what does this mean? What does this suggest? There is a tremendous reservoir of intelligence in each of us. There's a access, there's a touch point of deep intelligence and capacity and power and knowing and wisdom and love and acceptance and possibility in every human being. And why stop there? It's not just every human being, it's in everything just behind the veil of societal construction, the veil of social construction. Right? So just like right now, we can see each other through screens, in a sense. But behind the screen is the actual technology that's operating. Right? It's the technology that makes the screen possible. It's the technology that renders itself as the screen. It's a technology that actually allows the recognition, the communication, and all of that. Right? Similarly, this perceptual world is a kind of screen. But there is a technology here that's representing itself as this perceptual world. Sights, sounds, smells, tastes, textures, ideas, memories, thoughts, visual images, right? Past, present, future. These are all representations and splices of this technology. That native intelligence gets interpreted in various ways, right? So one is in medicine, one is in engineering, one is in art. We have all these fields of knowledge that human beings have created that are representing this native intelligence in modified form as per our own stream of consciousness, how we interpret this. Right? And then we have different kinds of societies. We have wealthy societies. We have different socioeconomic classes. We have different races. We have all kinds of different stuff based on our own stream of consciousness and how we're interpreting the experience of this native intelligence in space and time. And then within medicine, you have the different traditions like allopathy and homeopathy and Ayurveda and yoga, Chinese medicine, and same thing. So nutrition of the mind is all is recognizing all of this to different levels. Wherever we are, we open to this recognition rather than just looking through a tunnel the whole time and trying to find the answer through that tunnel. If I happen to focus on one thing, that technique might work for me. Then I shift attention to another technique, and you can have infinite such techniques to have infinite experiences. That's different from recognizing what this is, which is a different kind of healing. So what these people are telling us, what these amazing stories, apparently miraculous stories, are telling us is that the lenses that we are using are pretty narrow. And the lenses we are using are not capturing what is actually possible. They're just capturing certain stories, certain developments. But there are many other developments happening that are not captured in case studies, in literature, in media, and so on. And if they are, they're presented as flukes, right? Which basically ensures that they remain seen as flukes because we don't make any effort to systematize them like we do with established systems. So it becomes kind of self-fulfilling. So this gets into what we've talked about before, this nutrition of the mind, which is healing. There's the kind of healing that I talked about, which is a person healing from a kind of state or a condition and advancing to a forward state where that condition is no longer there. But there's also the kind of healing or wholeness that simply recognizes what is happening. In fact, a person does not have to recognize what's happening to heal from many of these conditions, right? And many times, I would say most people don't necessarily recognize. They simply recognize there's something more. Definitely more is possible. I feel something more is possible. Something more is happening. I can't put my finger on it, and something happens. And then they tend to know what to do to activate that because they have felt that in their experience. And there's another kind of healing where one recognizes what is happening, and it's not so much that the body has to be a certain way to heal. These are different interpretations, different lenses on what healing is. That maybe my body doesn't have to be a certain way for me to heal. Maybe that's not what it's all about. Right? And that's depends on that person and that lifetime, where they are, what their circumstances are. It's different for everyone. There are no real right answers or wrong answers here. And so one of the deepest kinds of nutrition or nourishment is seeing into the deeper layers of our nature. One of the deepest edifications, the most life-giving of all sustenance. Is seeing into the deeper nature of what we are. Because when you see into the deeper nature of what we are, we see into the deeper nature of what everyone is. Because we're all reflections of each other. Right, what I see in me is what I see as you. That's true for everyone, whether we realize it or not. And ultimately, what one sees in oneself is what one sees as the world, going beyond living being and non-living being or animate and inanimate. All of those are conceptual, depending on the degree of sensitivity of our perception and thought. So if we go beyond the grid of the physical world, the superimposition of the physical world, the representation, GPS coordinates of the physical structure is the actual constitution of our experiences, you know, like where our experiences are made, in a sense. You know, almost like I have an image of a blacksmith that might be making things. I've never seen a blacksmith make anything, but, you know, like forging it in the fire, creating something, right? Where is that? And then ultimately comes out with something, some product, and gives it to somebody, right? But where is that forged? It's forged in the fire of his workshop. That's behind the scenes. That's not, everybody doesn't see that. Everybody says, well, I want this, I need this, and they make it and give it to them. And that's outside the shop. But in the shop is where everything is forged. And that, in a sense, is behind this grid of experience. And in this domain, there are all kinds of happenings because that's not restricted to our physical space-time, right? In physical space-time, we have to go out the door, get in a car and go somewhere, get on a flight to go somewhere, right? Because those are the rules of that domain. But in the pre-physical domain, you know, it's not about traveling with vehicles, or it's mind-based, thought-based, attention-based, energy-based. And so the reason I'm saying that, because there are infinite possibilities, happenings in this domain. And the reason I'm saying this in general, under the context of nutrition for the mind, nutrition of the mind, is because this is what's happening. It's important to recognize to the extent that we can, and to the extent that we can actually integrate it in a useful way in our lives, rather than simply functioning only on the outer layer of life. It's 10 times more effort to get the same thing done. So moving into that softer space, that subtler space, right, where perception is not just happening through the eyes and through the ears and through the skin, but the eyes, the ears, the skin, and so on are actually representations of the way we perceive. We're not perceiving only through these channels, we're perceiving also through these channels at that point. And so there is this pre-physical space of experiences that are being churned, that are happening, you know, this, let's say, active world of events and happenings that are then influencing and representing what's happening in our physical space. That's a vast domain. Just like this world is a vast domain, can go forever in the physical world, right? Can go to all the way to the bottom of so many oceans. You can go to Australia, you can go to India, you know, you can travel the globe. If you have the technology, you can go to other planets, right? And if we had enough technology, how many other solar systems, galaxies, I mean, forever, in a sense. And just like that, so with the pre-physical space. Endless, endless, endless domains. And then also, that question still comes up of what is this? What is this pre-physical space? We know that in the physical space, we've largely been taught to think about it as the atomic world, but we know how limited that is. The atomic world is not even a fraction, well, it's a fraction of all that we know. But here on this planet, in our educational system, when we're students, you're largely talking about the atomic world. But we know that even the atomic world, when you go down to the smallest particle, is actually made of fields of energy, local vibration, and an infinite field of energy. So we don't really know what this world is made of. And then so you go to the pre-physical space, and the same question exists there. What is this actually? We know it's not atomic. But what is it? And it turns out it's the same thing. Whatever it is this physical space is made of, so too the pre-physical space is also constituted from. And so we get to this more original nature of what we are. Like, who are we prior to the body? And when I say prior, I don't mean prior to just temporally, in terms of time, but in depth, at a subtler level than the physical structure, who are we and what are we? Prior to all of these events and interactions, even in this pre-physical space, is a deeper nature of what we are that is unshakable by the events of the world. Because it represents itself through the events of the world. or our experiences in this lifetime. So we can see ourselves in these many layers. We can see the physical body, then we can see the mental body of activity. We can look at the chakras and the energetic body, you know, and we can go even more deeply informational and to the nature of consciousness. You can also see it how we just talked about it now, in terms of all of physicality and then the subtler world that represents itself also in dreams, in daydreams, but even all the time. It's just a matter of how we have learned to use our attention. It's always happening. It's always here. It's just how we use our attention. In the dream state, the attention is diverted to another dimension, right? And when the mind wakes up, it shifts attention back. But that same mind could simply expand so that both the subtle world and the physical world are both in its purview. Right? Just like you can look at this much of a windshield, but if you clean the whole windshield and all the windows, then you can see 270 degrees. So just because one has been looking this way the whole time doesn't mean it's the only way to look. Why is all this important? Because this is how we realize what's possible. This is how we realize what's happening. This is how we realize what resources are available to us beyond what we said, you know, having to point our lens one speck at a time and gaining knowledge that way and taking lifetimes to piece everything together. I'll pause here. Any thoughts or comments, feel free to jump in.
Could you elaborate a little bit more on taking lifetimes to piece things together? That was very powerful.
Each lifetime, so I'm going to take as a given that we all have multiple lifetimes. And I'm going to use the word lifetime very loosely as well, not just in terms of we leave this body and take another body. You know, this whole notion of dimensions, lifetimes, dreams, we always have to remember that these are our inventions. These are linguistic inventions to label and identify experiences that we're having. So we could say, okay, I had a dream last night and this happened. Or we could say, well, that was another dimension that I experienced last night. They're both true, right? Some people say they went to another planet. They remember going to another planet or what it's like on another planet. Some people say, well, that was a dream. Some people say, well, that was another dimension. Some people remember something and say, well, that was another lifetime. I was on a podcast recently and I talked about seeing another lifetime or experiencing another lifetime. They say, well, how do you know that's not just a dream? And I said, well, this whole thing is a dream. This is a dream too. You and me talking right now is dreamlike. I won't say it is a dream, but it's dreamlike, meaning the mechanics of how this is happening is the same. We can call it a dream. We can call it another lifetime. We can call it, it doesn't really matter that much, right? We're having experiences that are meaningful is the bottom line. How we categorize them is simply based on our sensitivity. And there's no way to really convey that if a person says, this was another lifetime and then this was a dream, there's not enough shared knowledge to convey what is what to distinguish between why one is called one and why one is called another. And it doesn't really matter, more to the point. Right, that's just a background. I'm getting to your question. I just wanted to give a background about that. Because our attention is so entrained on this shared physical space, as we call it, the physical space, that there's not enough shared language and understanding to talk about a broader swath of experience. To talk about it in a way that there would be shared understanding, right? Unless a person is willing to kind of take a ride, to go on that ride and experience for themselves and see. So the point is that, you know, when we have dreams or daydreams or even things that we might watch or see, things that are happening in our lives, these are events that are streaming in consciousness, and they all have meaning in the sense that in a way they're all leading us home. Right? So in a dream, we might have another body, right? Is it another lifetime? Is it just a dream? It might not matter so much. And yes, when even in this waking state, when this body is done, there'll be another body. Immediately, as soon as we leave this body, it might be the mental body, might not be the physical body. But the point is, at that point, it doesn't really matter. It's a body too. We have a great bias as to what we consider a body. It doesn't mean that our idea of a body is right. A body is essentially a representation, right? We talk about bodies of knowledge, bodies of water. Right? So we move from embodiment to embodiment to embodiment. What is an embodiment? An embodiment is a perspective, right? And on Earth, it might be a culture, a race, a set of ideas, you know, that we are born into, that we are embodied into, that gives us a certain lens, a certain angle on what is happening. Why? Because it's part of our journey home. What is home is recognizing what this is. Because there are infinite experiences in the expanse of space and time. It's literally infinite. Even on in your house, you could have infinite experiences. If you stay in one room for the rest of your life, you could have infinite experiences in that room, of that room, seeing it differently, different angles, staying in different parts of the room, staying in different ways in different parts of the room. Different ideas will come to you based on all those things. So no matter how small or big a space we're in, infinity is the nature of things. It's always showing, infinity is always showing itself to us through the finite. And as long as that's where we are, as long as that's where the attention is on these experiences, they keep happening in infinite ways. And we have different embodiments, different lifetimes, dreams, dimensions. It goes on and on and on and on. As long as the taste is for that, you know, I had salty food, now I want sweet food. Now it's sweet food, now I need something a little more just subtle, maybe just some water. Now I've had too much water, now I need juice or something like that, right? So it keeps moving through attention, through intention, through desire. These are the forces that drive us, attention, desire. Then the more that mind, let's say, recognizes what this is, recognizes what's happening. So it's not only invested in what is happening right now, but it's also recognizing more the nature of how things happen. And what is the big picture about how this is happening? And what is my role as an individual in this lifetime here? Like, what is this? So the more that kind of awareness arises, the less one needs to be embodied to have more and more experiences. It's kind of like a sign that there's a change coming. There's a change in process. And then there might be, that's just another stage. Now there might be more volition in terms of what happens, right? Rather than seeming to have these haphazard experiences. They're not haphazard, but apparently haphazard experiences, one experience after the other, you know, tumbling through different experiences. There might be much more awareness in terms of what is happening now. It's a different phase of existence, we can say. And the physical world is seen through, and what was previously known to be the physical world is recognized, what we call recognized. It's recognized as an expression of intention, desire, and one's journey home.
Anoop, can I say something?
Yes, please.
Oh, I was looking for a hand to hold up, but I didn't see that. So anyway, I have watched most of your interviews, I think, and Buddha at the Gas Pump a couple times. I've read your books, and I've been at this for quite a while, let me tell you, about 12 years, 13 years maybe. 2 hours meditation every day, shikantaza, trying. I'm just starting to wake up. And I know I'm not this body. I'm way beyond that, especially when I'm in shikantaza and meditating. And you've helped me so much. You have no idea, you know, your teachings. The problem, I guess it's a problem I have, is no one I know really understands us. It's like I'm alone, you know. I hear you. I know exactly where you're coming from, you know. I go to a party and people are talking. I feel like a phony, you know, telling my story where I, you know, there's nobody inside here. And it's just, I tend to contract when I'm around people. And it's just nice to, you know, to hear, you know, that from you and people that are awake that, you know, what I'm feeling is, you know, the real deal. That's reality. You know, it's just, I was trying to explain it to my wife today. I was saying about emptiness. I see the emptiness in everything. You know, there's no substantiality in any of this material world, but in the same breath, it's fullness, because it's wholeness, because it's just like one thing. It's one thing, everything's connected, and it's just mind-blowing. But I just kind of wanted to get that out, and just, I appreciate, you know, your teaching so much. And thank you.
Thank you for getting it out. It's so important to get it out. If anybody else wants to let it out, let it out. This is the place.
Yeah, I just want to say something. Yeah, I mean, when you talk, it just resonates so deeply, and it's just so rare to hear, like, as I've said to you before, that when you speak, it's just so comprehensive in a way that I just have never heard it from anyone else. And it rings so true to me. It just, like, I get to, through this field, I have a sense of this complete picture. And a question arises, I wonder if you could talk about, is that I'm still sitting with that Sanskrit word prarabdha that Ramana talks so much about, which is that each lifetime that we were born into, or each dream, is that there are certain things that we have to go through that was already predestined, whether we want it or not. Because there is still a divine force, a divine intelligence that is guiding each soul, whatever you call this thing, that we will each have to learn. So which means that whatever I desire, that doesn't mean that I will have what I desire, because if it's not part of the predestiny, it's not going to happen. Could you talk about a lot about, because then I just practice just being with what is, you know, because it's, a lot is not in my control, even though I'm always, you know, knowing, resting back into who I am.
Yeah. This is where understanding the second mind view through the first mind view can help. Prarabdha is what is coming through, the lot that is coming through a person for that lifetime.
Mm.
It's like a person's allotment of experience, you could say. Right? It's like when you check your bags to go on a flight and you arrive in the new country, you have your baggage. This baggage is with you. and you will contend with it in one way or another. You know, that's what has come with you. You have a whole bunch of other stuff, but it hasn't come with you on this trip. Right? So what has come with you on this trip is prarabdha. And it has to be dealt with. You may have some ugly clothes. You may have some good clothes. You may have warm clothes in a cold environment. You may have appropriate clothes. You get the whole mixed bag, whatever has come with you on this trip. And you deal with it. You might have to cut the sleeves off of something if it's too hot. You might have to stitch something together. You may have some holes in one. You know, but that is that process of recognizing what this is. You know, what we would consider heaven, what has been talked about as heaven in many traditions, there can be a kind of heaven that's also a kind of boredom, ultimately. And everything is always pleasant. Yes, it feels good, feels good, feels good, feels good, feels good. And eventually it's kind of like, well, what is this? The same question arises even there. It may take a lot longer because there's no pain. There's no, the depth or the kind of pain that's here in this world may not be there, right? But ultimately that question is there. Even in those places, there is a spirituality that for us would be considered an enlightened society. That would be an enlightened society. But for that society, there's also an enlightenment, right? So the prarabdha, the things that come with us are, they give us the shades of experience that give us opportunities to see through the cracks to what this is. Otherwise, if you have the perfect thing all the time, that's, if you're suffering, it's great. Don't get me wrong. There's so much suffering on this planet. Everybody should experience that. Everybody should have that kind of problem, right? Of course. I'm just saying that prarabdha, it gives an opportunity, it gives the texture to a lifetime.
So is it the divine intelligence that's controlling all the different realms, even the heavenly realm, the hell realm, this earth realm, that each soul or whatever you call, you know, continue to evolve and continue to learn? What's the power that makes the each soul continue to evolve?
You can see it from different perspectives. So if a person takes themselves to be an individual, this is what I am, then there is this greater intelligence that's okay, kind of running everything, right? I don't make the, as an individual, I don't make the trees grow. I don't make my heart beat. I don't make myself be born and so on, right? The whole view of the three minds is that this individual is a representation of what we are.
Yeah.
There is an aspect of us, most of what we are exists outside of this lifetime, not in this lifetime. And a part of us is represented in this lifetime, right? So then as that, we are much more part of that tapestry, part of that intelligence. We are aspects of this intelligence. So we are kind of, you know, governing ourselves in a sense. So it just depends on the stance you take of who you are and what you are. But the point is that there is only intelligence. There's nothing that's ignorant somewhere that's of the nature essentially of ignorance, right? It just shows itself to different extents. And that intelligence is contiguous, meaning like there's no boundary between me and some other intelligence, except if I identify as this, then there is that boundary to the extent that I identify. Mm-hmm. To the extent that I expand, then there's that connection among all things. So there's no right or wrong answer. It just depends on how you see yourself and how you see this universe, mm-hmm. right? So is it a God who's governing me, or is it this intelligence that we all are at different scales? It's different ways of looking at it. Ernie, I want to come back to what you said. You talked about the emptiness and the fullness. As that mind starts to wake up, it basically starts to wake up from all the stories we were told about what this world is. And especially if you're meditating regularly and deeply, the perception becomes very sensitive and you start to kind of see the non-substantiveness of the independent physical world. You can kind of see through the physical world in a sense. And that's where the emptiness comes from. And that emptiness more and more and more turns into absolute fullness and possibility as the mind stays in its deeper and deeper nature. Because the emptiness is kind of like the look from the outside to the inside as you kind of look through it and you're like, wow, there was nothing here that was independently substantial. All the substantiality came from somewhere else. And as the mind identifies and lives as that something else, that becomes a fullness. Because now what it's recognizing as true and full is that potential nature. But in the world, in the society, we're taught to recognize objects as real and full. And so that mind gets hooked. That mind is addicted to objects, which is why meditation can be hard for some people, because it's hard to let go, because then it's like, well, where am I? There's nothing here. But as the mind gets more sensitive and recognizes that what was previously seen as there is nothing here is actually what is actually true. There's actually something here. There is that reality or whatever one wants to call it. And as it lives as that more and more, then the emptiness is transformed into fullness, into everythingness, into possibility, but to all these things, beauty, power, capacity, beautiful things.
I was on a flight from Doha, Qatar into Goa, and sort of what you said, so what you were saying is what I was feeling on that, you know, going into, from Qatar into Goa. One of the things I've been focusing on recently, I don't know, focusing on, but sort of viewing this is, and maybe you mentioned it, this is all consciousness. Maybe Deepak mentioned it. I believe it's energy, and I know energy is consciousness, but it's all consciousness. Wherever that consciousness happens to go, you know, and we can control that consciousness. And the other thing I was thinking of in this moment was, you know, the maybe it's the sutras of Patanjali. This is all an illusion. It's amazing. You know, it's all happening behind the eyeballs, you know. I see you, but that experience is happening inside of this bodhi, this chitta, this that's going on inside of my head.
Yeah, there's so many ways of putting this. I tend to say it's a representation rather than illusion. That's just my choice of words. It can be misleading in some circumstances to see it as illusion, but it's certainly not what it seems to be, not what we've been told it is in the educational system. That I think everybody would agree with, no matter what words we choose. There's much, much more to it than simply what we've been trained to see. And we don't really know what the other person sees, because the sight is happening in the mind and also through the eyes rather than strictly through the eyes. So we don't really know, but we know that the general popular public story is a fraction of what this world is.
Dr. Kumar, I was just wondering, when you said to clean the windshield wipers, I was thinking what would you recommend as the process of cleaning the windshield wiper? And the other thing is once it's clean and you see things that you've never seen before, how do you then navigate where you're going?
Excellent question. Our approach that we always talk about is the four engines, activating the four engines, nutrition, movement, connection, and rest. If you send me an email at healing@healthrevolution.org, that's the email address, healing@healthrevolution.org, and just ask me this and I'll send you a couple of resources. I'll send you a couple of articles. I'll send you the course that we have to activate these engines. Essentially, you know, what we're talking about is moving into a deeper level of awareness, very simply, right? And simply put, that's what we're talking about. And that can happen in any ways, because everything is intelligence in a sense. So there's no way to do it, right? Meaning there's no only one way to do it. There are infinite ways to do it. And sometimes all of them won't work. And sometimes in the next moment, it just happens. You know, there are ways to tilt the scale in one's favor to kind of do this and for it to kind of slowly seep in. And sometimes it just happens as well. Apparently it's never just out of the blue. Although it seems like that, there's always a pattern through lifetimes, and there's always a process to it, but it can seem like it's out of the blue. What we can do, what we can always do, is prepare the foundation and set the stage, which is as important as anything else. Because as you said, okay, we cleaned the windshield, now we open up, and now it's like, whoa, how do I navigate this world, right? How do I remain a person in this society? That's something I had to deal with for a long time, to figure out who I wanted to be and how I wanted to be in this society. And that's these four engines, nutrition, movement, connection, and rest, come from my trial and error of figuring out how to be in the society. That's how they were born. You know, I didn't make them up by reading anybody's book. I didn't, it was like my, when I looked back on what I'd done, I was like, these are the four things I need. It's not that they're cool or they'd be fun. It's like, I need these to occupy this range of consciousness where I can express in this world without falling too much to one side or the other. They're my stabilizers. Right? And what those are, we can go into that, because that's a whole conversation. We can go into that. Send me the email. The things that are in our subconscious, first of all, like, everybody knows what is true. Everybody knows what's true, because we've all been there multiple times, hundreds of times, thousands of times. This is a small fraction of experience within the lifetime, where the mind narrows down so it doesn't access all that, because it will be too much. There's no way we can function within one stream of consciousness and carry all that simultaneously. There has to be a narrowing of attention, right? Just like if you had to do something, when you first had to drive, you had to focus on the road very closely. Now you probably could do 10 things, maybe, and still be relatively safe, because it's become rote in a sense. So your awareness can expand. They didn't used to allow radios in the car because they said you couldn't handle that attention, right? Now they're like video screens everywhere in a car. So I'm not saying it's good or bad, but the point is, as your attention, as your skill develops, your attention can expand and hold more. And the four engines, nutrition, movement, connection, rest, are ways of developing your skill, your mental skill. Releasing, a lot of it is cleaning out the stuff, the old stuff that doesn't need to be there, that everybody is carrying around, because this society is generally not good at cleaning out old stuff and keeping what we need to navigate. So in the subconscious mind is a recognition of what's true, but there's also a lot of baggage in the subconscious mind. So how do you release that? So the food you eat makes a difference as to whether the baggage stays or whether it's released, right? The conversations you have make a difference as whether the baggage stays or it's released. How you breathe makes a difference in whether it stays or it's released. How you move your body, how much you move your body makes a difference. Everything makes a difference, because everything is consciousness. So there's no line where we say, well, that's the body, that I'm spiritual, I'm working on the mind, or I'm working on my wisdom, or I'm working on my consciousness, not the body. You know, the body is consciousness also. So it's really cool, because you have kind of infinite tools, right? And they can, you never know what makes a difference. Like for some people, it can just be twisting back and forth this way, releases something in the pelvis and the lower abdomen and the back. Huge breath release, and they just feel all of a sudden lighter, and their perception becomes subtler. Like, you never know what's going to be, you know, it's like it's what the portal is, because everything is consciousness. So you never know what the portal is going to be for you, right? It might be you look at a flower, you see something, and something opens up. So to come back to your question, activating these engines, what they do is make the mind more subtle. And it develops your own natural intelligence, which is ultimately what we're talking about here. This is not learning something from somebody else. This is a reminder so that a person's own native intelligence starts up, powers up, and comes through. And then you know how to navigate it. If a person doesn't do these things and their awareness just expands, then that problem could be there. How do I navigate this? Right? And that problem does happen. It happens with a lot of people doing psychedelics, ayahuasca, a lot of these. I've talked to people who have done these things and who have, many times great things happen, But you cannot say only great things will happen to me. The opening of the mind is the opening of the mind. It will open everything, especially if it's done like in a hit, you know, in one big opening. So then one has to navigate those things. And that has to be done through nutrition, movement, connection, and rest. That's where you develop the groundedness, the stability, your one's own innate awareness and discernment. This is how you navigate those things. Does that make sense? Yeah. Yeah. So there's the how to open up to that level of awareness and perceive in that subtler way. And then there is how to navigate that opening. How do you manage that? And there, I don't want to say two different things, but there are two different aspects of the process that are critical. Because the first part can be very fascinating, but that's where we see a lot of the confusion with what we call mental illness, some kinds of psychosis. You know, a lot of the misunderstanding is in this area where there's no knowledge about, one, what is the nature of things, and two, how do you navigate that as a character in the society? All right, let's do a brief meditation now, and then we'll wrap up. So see if you can just get wild and open up all your spaces. So what does that mean? It means letting go of the boundaries between physical world, the mental world, spiritual world, all these worlds, these dimensions. These compartmentalizations of what we are. Take a deep breath. Let the breath move through the whole body. Feel that intelligence move through the whole body. That tremendous, incredible intelligence that organizes the cosmos. So many different kinds of meditation, and they vary based upon how we use attention. How we direct awareness. Get a sense for how you are using attention now. Where is the frame of attention? What is it noticing? Is it in the physical space around? Is it on the body? Is it on personal thoughts? Is it sensing the energetic space? Like, how is attention being directed in this moment? What is the tendency? Is it focal? Is it on a point or in a region? Is it more expanded? If expanded, how expanded? Into what volume of space or mind? If you notice and bring your awareness to that, what you notice is that you have so many options for your attention and your range. And there's so much power in how you choose. In where you spread the spotlight or the floodlight of your awareness. You have a tremendous amount of power. A tremendous ability to know what this is and what's happening. And wherever the frame of your attention is, now expand it to include another range. Meaning, see the boundary between the ranges as simply superimposed rather than independently real. That boundary too is in your awareness. Recognize that when you're going through your day, attention is selecting out a frame, a range. Commonly accepted social range of attention. Now gather all the attention and bring it to a focal point with the body. Let's say behind the navel. Pick a point a few inches behind the navel within the body and bring all your attention focused behind that area. And see if you can sense any changes in the body. The more one's engines are activated, nutrition, movement, connection, and rest, the more these shifts in awareness and intention through conscious choice have powerful effects, because the baggage is cleared out and the lens is clear. Waking up to these different ranges of awareness is literally mind-blowing, because it blows off the boundaries of the socialized mind. And slowly open the eyes. And when you open the eyes, notice that your frame is still expanded. Even if the eyes are open, the attention does not have to be just in the physical space. Physical space is occupying a segment of the mind's capacity. It's not all of the mind's capacity. So there can be multiple streams of consciousness streaming. Physical space is one.